so long since last we met.
Lie down, forever lie down. Or have you any money to bet? Lie down, forever lie down. There goes old Georgetown, straight for a touchdown. See how they gain ground. Lie down, forever lie down. Lie down, lie down, forever lie down.
Hello and welcome to 1789 Seconds, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Thank you for joining us today. We're so happy you're here. Through this series, we spend 1,789 seconds with a Georgetown alumnus as they share their incredible stories. I'm Julie Farr from the college class of 1988. I'm a parent of three Hoyas from 19, 21, and 24, and I serve as the executive director of the Georgetown University Alumni Association. We're here today with Eddy Yablans, a fellow graduate from the college class of 1988, who since leaving Georgetown has been a talent agent for 35 years and counting. Eddy, it's been so long since last we met. It's great to see you.
Hi, Julie. How are you, honey?
Thanks for joining. Great to see you. So before we start,
Julie and I, you know, we're friends. You know, we have lunch, we hang out. You know, this is no big deal for us to sit here and gab for a half hour.
We're just chatting. You West Coast, me East Coast.
That's right.
So we're 88ers, and I think we have a good group of 88ers joining us today. So thanks for everyone for being here. 88's had kind of a moment in the last couple of years. We have a couple John Carroll awardees from Emily Chen and Jack McDonald last year, and we just awarded the Gas Award to Frank Belizzi for service. I just had a great conversation to Andrea Yayora Clark about her new book, A Night Under a Thousand Stars. And I know many 88ers out there doing amazing things like you are, Eddy. So thank you for taking time for us today to tell us about your story since you got to Georgetown. So let's jump into the Wayback Machine together, shall we? How did you find...
Although the Jack McDonald event was great. We all got COVID, so it was fantastic.
Yeah, many of us did.
We only do it big in the class of 88, you know, everyone got COVID. It was fantastic.
But we're all here.
Sorry, I interrupted you.
Tell us about how you found your way to Georgetown.
Well, I was a senior in high school in L.A. and wanted to get out of L.A. as badly as I could and as fast as I could. And Patrick Ewing was, they had just won the national championship, and I wanted to study government or politics at the time. And it was a hot, cool school, and I was desperate to get out of L.A. And I'd been in D.C. the summer before on a school trip. And I fell in love with the campus and the neighborhood, and it was my first and only choice. And I was fortunate enough to get in and had an incredible experience. And to this day, it's four of my favorite years of my life, as you know, because we've talked about it often.
Mine too. Tell us about your years here. So do you have favorite classes? What'd you do after class? Places you studied, places you didn't study?
You know, the thing about Georgetown for me, there were two things that were meaningful. First, it was a liberal arts education I really embraced, and particularly there were classes I didn't want to take that I didn't like taking. Geology freshman year was definitely right up there as not something I was too enthralled with, but I did love Problem of God, and I did love my English courses that I took freshman year that were part of the core curriculum. And I was
remember who taught you Problem of God.
A guy named John Haught, who was an amazing, amazing professor. And I ended up taking his upper level theology class to fulfill my requirement, but it wasn't about fulfilling the requirement. I just thought he was amazing. He taught me all about cosmology and meaning of life in the universe. It just really connected with me very deeply. That and my short story and English class, those were the two most impactful classes, even much more than my major classes, which I loved, you know, in American government, but those classes meant a lot to me. And actually, when I look back and think about what I do for a living, I didn't really have like this burning desire to go be a talent agent. It wasn't like, this is what I have to do with my life. But when I think about it, those classes were, you know, touched on creativity and touched on, you know, storytelling and the meaning of life. And so when I do what I do for a living, it's a business job, but it's also a creative job because I read scripts and I see movies and television and theater and read books. And I have to have some ability to connect with clients and with buyers over that material. And I look back at Georgetown, like the government stuff was great because I wanted to be a consultant. That's what I was aiming towards. But the the creative part of what I do was really touched by those, informed by those classes. So those were things that were very meaningful to me.
Yeah, it's that great liberal arts education. So you came in, but you wanted to pursue government. That was just because you had an idea for a career.
I was just interested in politics. I still am. I mean, I still consume a lot of media and news and constantly, you know, my wife will tell you I'm always on Twitter reading what reporters and commentators are saying. Our politics are so awful now. But back in the 80s, it was a different time. And I just was really interested in the strategy of it and the competition of it. And I was going to go in. I had an internship for about a day senior year, and I was stuffing envelopes at some Democratic firm, and I thought, nah, I got my whole life to do this. I'm going to go back to school and just enjoy my senior year. And I mean, it's so different from what kids do now, because everyone's so obsessed with internships and, you know, figuring out your career path at 22. And I was like, no, I want to go back and party and have fun my senior year. I have my whole life to work. It's actually advice I give. I do a lot of Georgetown externships, and kids are always calling me asking, you know, how do I get in entertainment? And they're all like, I'm graduating in 3 years and I've got 10 internships. I said, what are you doing? If your whole life to work, you know, enjoy these 4 years, suck as much out of Georgetown, because you never have that time back.
Right. So, and it goes by so fast. I mean, kids have graduated. Mine, I have my last one coming through this semester, and it flies by. It's great advice. And I'd say our students today are really drilled down to pursuing one path and think they have to build just towards that one path, which is not what you did. And I'm going to pull you back to the 80s again. You wrote for The Voice, The Hoya. You had a radio show. I didn't know you had a radio show. Didn't even know we had radio shows.
Well, no one did. I mean, I don't think anyone... I think we have more people on this webinar than we ever had on a radio show. I think that one of the things I loved about school too then, and it's different now, and I experienced it through my daughter who graduated a couple of years ago and my son who went to Georgetown for the first couple of years and ended up transferring, is that the culture now, the club culture now, from what I understand, is so different from what I experienced, because there were no barriers to entry really to do anything except your own desire to do it. So I don't know why I ended up writing for The Voice. I'd covered the freshman intramural basketball league.
Very
for the
hot topic.
Section. No, I think I did that actually for The Hoya. I don't remember anymore. I wrote for both papers, and I did it just freshman year. I may have done something sophomore year. I have some stuff. I should have looked through it at home. I have some old articles I wrote and stuff I wrote about the Grateful Dead and all that. I reviewed one of their shows at the Cap Center. I really, really enjoyed that. I had no interest in being a journalist. It was just fun to be a part of it, and it was fun covering the intramural basketball league. That was just weird. And the radio show, we did have a radio station there. Oh, I still have a flyer from my show that someone sent me recently. It was WGTB. It was only piped in through wire to the dorm, so literally no one listened. But I had the show was from like 12 to 2 a.m. on Sunday nights. I mean, now I'm in bed at 9. And it was a Grateful Dead show, and I would have friends come, and it ended up being more of a before Howard Stern was anybody really, it was an interview show. So I'd have my idiot friends on, and we would, you know, partake in festivities, and then we'd talk about, we had a show called Jews in a Jesuit Society. That was like our big thing, you know. I have that tape somewhere.
I won't ask you to name names on any idiot friends of yours. But in all this, because I'm gonna pull you back again.
Okay, sorry.
You had your first sort of talent experience when you were here at Georgetown. So your first client story, cabaret, involving Jim Gaffigan and McDonald.
Again, if you look back, I never really had, sort of over the years, these things have come into my head. Oh yeah, that's how I ended up doing what I'm doing for a living. So senior year, Jack McDonald, who's a great friend and a great human being, wanted to host cabaret, which back in those days, I don't know what it's like now, but that was the social event of the year at Georgetown. And if you hosted it, that was a huge deal. And Jack and Jim Gaffigan were going to host it. And I was buddies with Jim, and he always made me laugh. He was just a funny, funny guy. It's not a surprise. You know, he's a hugely successful stand-up. And so I worked with them on their audition. And we, you know, I guess you could say I directed them or produced them or something like that. And I had a ball doing it, and they got the job. So I didn't realize that till many, many years later. Oh yeah, that was me being an agent. I was really working with these guys to help them get a gig, and they got the gig. And then Gaffigan went on to have, you know, crazy careers. So that was my first experience. I was also thinking, Julie, I wasn't meant for like my best friend, Ed Wolf. We've been friends since we were 6 years old. I give that guy so much credit for building Wolf Research into a huge business. He could tolerate a lot of risk. I remember senior year, Larry Botel and Frank Perelli and I had this idea. I had an idea to create these t-shirts for the senior class. And Frank Perelli did the artwork and Larry was my business partner. And man, I couldn't tolerate the risk. We put in like $1,000 and I was so petrified we wouldn't sell the t-shirts that I was like, oh my God, we're gonna go bankrupt and all that. We ended up selling every t-shirt. In fact, Frank and I spoke recently. We're gonna do a t-shirt for our 40th reunion in a couple of years. But so agenting was a little like less risk. I was a little more risk averse and I could get into a company and sign clients and have a business. And that was more my style. So that was another experience at Georgetown that led me down a path. That's the point of that story.
So then we all left Healy Gates at 1988 and you went to New York. Did you have an idea what you were going to do at that point?
Well, I wasn't really ready for school to be over. So I was having way too much fun. So I really... You know, now I will say something good about this generation is the ability to take more time to figure out what you're going to do. And I feel like, at least for me, and I know some people who went to Europe and backpacked through Europe and some people who, you know, who try different things. I felt like I needed to go to work. I wanted to go to work. I liked to work. But I wasn't really prepared emotionally really to have the responsibilities of a full-time gig at that point in terms of like knowing what I wanted. So I was happy to work. I was an assistant at ICM in New York. I wanted to live in New York City. I did not want to move back to LA where the entertainment business was. The agencies in those days, they still have New York offices, but in those days they had really thriving offices because there was no email or texting or anything. So it was a very different world and there were a lot of actors in New York. That was a good outpost. And so I did that for 4 years. And then I moved to LA in 1992, and that was when I really started my career. That's when I really felt like, okay, I'm going to get serious about this.
I remember the New York years. I went to a really good party at your house on the Upper West Side for New Year's Eve 1 year. It was completely packed. Everyone was from Georgetown. Do you remember that?
It's huge. I mean, that was a historic party. It was Jack McDonald's birthday is on New Year's Eve.
Right.
You know, we would have that party every year. First, it was me and Ed Wolf, and then Gavin Fraser and I, and then I left and Gavin and Frank Perelli had that party. So that party went on for a good 5 years at 106 West 76. It was a rager. Right, I'd have it again.
I also know, so we'll, before you got to LA, so your dad, Frank, ran Paramount and MGM Studios.
Yeah.
As a film producer, did you have a sense that this was somewhere in your blood that you wanted to follow and in this industry inspired by your father?
Well, definitely. I mean, he was a very cool guy. He was very charismatic and fun, a great dad. And I used to go out with him we used to go out for meals, you know, because my parents got divorced when I was like 14. So I would see him. We'd go on Sunday mornings. I'll drop a few LA cool restaurants. And we go to the Pole Lounge for breakfast on Sundays. And we go to the old Spago, which was the original cool place, or the old Morton's, the original cool place. This won't mean a lot to the audience, but if you know Hollywood and history at all, those were the places to go. And so I'd go with him and I'd watch him kind of work the room and people come to the table and say hi. And I was like, I want to be like that. That's cool. What that guy's doing is cool. I had no idea really what it was. I didn't realize that until many years later that was something that I was turned on by. So, but again, when I got out of college, I was going to go into consulting and I called my roommate, Doug Martilla's dad was a guy named John Martilla, who passed away recently, who was a really big Democratic consultant in Boston, did a lot of national campaigns with Joe Biden's guy. And I called him kind of hoping he'd offer me a job, really under the guise of asking for advice. But I was kind of hoping he'd slip in, hey, come work for me. And that didn't happen. In fact, he said he had just consulted on a movie, a Richard Gere movie. I forget what it was called, but it was about politics. And he said, go in Hollywood, you'll make a lot more money. You'll have a lot more fun. So that's how like unfocused I was. Like when I see kids these days, like they know exactly what I'm like. God, I was so not like that. I was like, okay, I'll go do this.
All right. You know? So now you're in LA.
Working out okay. 35 years later, it worked.
It
out.
Has. You started at Creative Artists Agency, right? And then
I started at ICM.
Oh, I'm sorry. So it's now. Sorry, that's it. It was so you currently work at Creative Artists. You started at ICM, which was bought by Creative Artists by CAA.
That's right.
You were a part of the building of ICM, right?
I came in ICM as an employee in 1988. In 2012, there was a management buyout of the old ICM. And I was part of the group that led that buyout. And it was called, we renamed the company ICM Partners because it became a partnership, which was a much better way to run that kind of business. And then we were bought by Creative Artists about 2 years ago. So now I work for CAA, who's always been forever was our arch rival. So now I work for the dark side. And my daughter works here too.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
In New York?
Yeah. Juliana was an English major at Georgetown and wanted to get into publishing. And I said, go work at the same advice my dad gave me, which was go work at the agency. This is what I always tell young people. If they come to Hollywood, what should you do? Come work at an agency because you get exposed to the entire business. Yeah. It's kind of like early on at Georgetown where you can play with lots of different things. So you come to an agency. If you walk around the halls here, everyone's young, first of all. So it's really fun when you get out of college because you're around your peers. You know, you're not stuck in a job with people who are 20 years old than you are there. Every single person here is 22, 23 years old, assistants to agents. And that's how, and you have a chance to be exposed if you want to work in film or TV or publishing or endorsements or sports or whatever. The agency gives you that opportunity. So I said the same thing to her. My dad said to me, she's interested in publishing. So she's now working for an icon of publishing, a woman named Esther Newberg, and she's her assistant and thriving and loving it. And so we both work here. Really cool.
Speaking of thriving in your career, you've worked with Hollywood's biggest stars, Ellen DeGeneres, Chris Rock, Liam Neeson, Ray Romano. What's been your most exciting kind of pinch me moment?
I remember actually a time I came to DC. You and I had dinner the night before. Look, there have been lots of, this is a really exciting and fun job. It's hard. I mean, you're dealing with artists every day, which is inherently fraught with, you know, emotion and insecurity because the world of artists is just, that's part of their world. And you know, your job is to, you know, get them employment, which it can be filled with a lot of pressure. And you're also competing with your other rival agencies who are trying to steal your business. I don't know if people always say, like, is your life like, what was that show on HBO? You know, Entourage. Is your life like Entourage? Entourage was like this super, you know, hyper reality, very funny and all that. And there's some truth to it. But the show that really reminded me of the agency business was Mad Men. Mad Men was much more like what it's like, and that all that conniving and stealing and all that. So it's an intense job. It's a really fun job, and it's a really exciting job. So I've had lots of exciting moments. But I would say probably the one I'm most proud of is when Ellen DeGeneres got the Presidential Medal of Freedom, because I was very involved in making that happen for her, because I really believed in her story, what she did. I remember one time I was sitting in my office and I saw that someone got the Presidential Medal of Freedom. This is during the Obama years. I thought, well, if that person got it, Ellen deserves it. My God, look what she's done. She's like, as Chris Rock refers to her, as the Black Rosa Parks. I mean, she basically sacrificed everything to be true to who she is. And I've learned so much from her in that regard. And so I was very helpful with a partner of mine, helped us get in touch with the Obama White House. And we were very instrumental in her getting that award. So she invited me to go along with her. And just watching President Obama talk about her in the same way I would have talked about her was really very moving. So that was like a kind of a career pinch. I mean, being in the White House and there's Bruce Springsteen right next to me and Robert De Niro it was just really, really cool. Some guy who invented, you know, like Earth was there. I mean, like, you know, we're all focused on Bruce Springsteen, you know, like.
So and then there's that is an amazing. I remember our evening having dinner and you were telling me about the contracts working with all the Hollywood stars and how some people wouldn't sign their contracts when Mercury was in retrograde and things like that you had to deal with.
Did I tell you that? Yes. No, I'm sure that's true. I don't recall that story, but I've had some funny experiences with actors doing weird things. So, you know.
And then a couple other, you were at the backstage of the Oscars or some sort of selfie.
Yeah, the selfie moment was really cool when Ellen did the selfie. That was a bit that went wrong, but ended up being amazing. Because if you ever look at that clip, she's like, actually the picture's right over here, but I think it was Bradley Cooper had the phone and he kept grabbing it out of her hand. And she was supposed to have the phone and like taking the selfie. He kept grabbing it. I could just see, oh my God, this bit's falling apart. Ended up being magical. And that actually hurt. That selfie ended up starting. One cool thing I was able to do with some colleagues of mine was create Ellen Digital Ventures, which was before you see like Hello Sunshine and you see these companies that were able to capitalize on their digital footprints to create real businesses. We did that with Ellen because in 2014, Twitter was still just becoming something. It was only been around for, I don't know if it had been around for more than this, but it seemed like it was only relevant in the culture for a couple of years. And because she broke Twitter that night, we were able to take that and turn it into a business and really capitalize on her big social platform. It was a very lucrative business and a really exciting thing. So my wife keeps texting me and saying, I got to talk to David Letterman moment. So one time, Ellen was doing an interview. If you can go online and look on this on Netflix, one of my moments of fame, I'm in the audience and Letterman, who to me was our generation, he's a comedy icon and a legend and amazing. And he doesn't do stand-up, so you could never see him live. And he came out, he was interviewing her, but he came out and did 10 minutes before to warm up the audience. And it was incredible. And so I'm sitting there and I'm sitting next to Ellen's executive producer who had been at Letterman EP. So they knew each other, and he sees her next to me and he starts talking to her and he goes, who's that guy? And he starts picking on me for like 5 minutes. And it's throughout, if you watch the thing, I'm in there. And it was amazing. Like being roasted by David Letterman live on Netflix was an absolute career highlight. And if you haven't,
what am I Googling for that? Letterman.
No, you have to go on Netflix and watch, I forget the name of the show, but watch the David Letterman interviews with Ellen DeGeneres. You'll see it. And now I was in the dentist chair and the hygienist is like, oh my God, I saw you on Letterman. You were amazing. And like, I would walk around, people would recognize me. One time I was with Ellen at a stand-up show and it was a corporate appearance and the CEO of the company, like some like, you know, logistics company says, you were amazing on Letterman to me. I'm sitting next to her. I said, Ellen. She goes, do people really recognize you from that? I said, yes. She started laughing, but it was hysterical. So those are some, you know, some fun moments.
And you were backstage with Chris Rock during the Netflix, I don't know, first live event.
The live show, yeah. Last March. God, it was a year ago. It was a year ago right now, today, that I flew to Baltimore for the test shows. And then a few weeks later, we did the first live Netflix event ever. I mean, it was not just the first stand-up special live, but it was a very, you know, it was paid close attention to because of all the stuff you went through with Will Smith at the Oscars. And
right.
that whole thing was a trip. I mean, that was a year of just craziness, but that was anytime. I always like doing this job because anytime you can be in the middle of really cool stuff, it's really fun. And I don't know, man, I've had the same job for 35 years and almost 36. And it's because it's very dynamic. You're working with really interesting people and you're doing really interesting things. And every now and then something will pop up that's just fascinating. And like, that was a really cool experience being backstage, working with him. It wasn't just being backstage. I was involved with the deal making and all the prep for it. And it was very complicated and it was a high wire act for him. I'm so proud of Chris because he had so much pressure on him in so many ways and he did an amazing job. So I'm just proud to be a part of that. I played in some bands in college. You know, I played the drums and I was really very mediocre and the bands were mediocre. Shout out to the Homogenized Cows. That was our sophomore band, by the way. We were.
You had your radio show and you were writing for the Police in Ohio.
Julie, where were you, man? It was.
I was working at the alumni house across the street for 4 years. I didn't.
You were like a normal human being, unlike me. It was called the Homogenized Cows because it's for THC. That's how stupid we were, okay? And but what was interesting about that band was that a guy named Doug Derryberry was in the band. He was a freshman. We were sophomores. And he was so clearly better than us. He was so clearly in another realm of talent that senior year I got invited to be in like a really good band. Like a band I was like the guys from Idle Minds and the guys from some other big band. And I was like, oh my God, they invited me to be in that. And I lasted two rehearsals, they kicked me out. So what I realized
that one, it wasn't Idle Minds, was it?
No, it was like a combo of idol. It was like Doug Derryberry and John Alasia and a couple other people. I was like, oh my God, I get to play drums in this band. And I was not up to par. I just was not good enough. And they threw me out.
We and I look back on
it. Hey man, I tried. But what I realized is I'm not the talent. Okay. I'm better off being behind the scenes. And there are people like my son, Leo, is a really talented jazz saxophonist. I mean, he's amazingly talented. He's a real professional musician. So I'm glad someone in the family got it, because it certainly wasn't me. I'm really good behind the scenes and all that.
Leo perform his freshman year when he was here at the Kennedy Center in the Let Freedom Ring concert.
Right.
With Martin Luther King. He was awesome.
Right. Yeah.
And I think another time. Anyway, so, okay, so besides film and television, you work in other industries. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, when you do, I mean, when you're an agent, you can touch a lot of different areas of the entertainment business. So my primary focus is in film and television actors. But I also, because I have actors who can do things like endorsements and publishing and personal appearances and stuff like that, I'm involved in those areas too. But my primary focus is in film and television. So when you see actors, I just got a client, a woman named Leslie Bibb, who's been a client of mine for a long time. She just got the new White Lotus season. So she's in Thailand shooting White Lotus season 3 right now, so when you see her in that show, the guy behind the scenes helping her get that gig was me and my team. And that was fun. Getting her that job was really exciting, because that's the hottest show on TV right now.
I'm going to ask you a couple more questions, because we do what we do. We've talked for 27 minutes. I'm going to give you two. What does it mean to be an agent today, just quickly, from what it was 35 years ago? And then tell us about Georgetown and how your experience at Georgetown has influenced and impacted your life, as quickly as you can. You have a problem.
The job is the same. It never changes. If you go back and read the Lou Wasserman biography, when he was an agent in the 1950s, it's the same job. In fact, there was a great biography of Joseph Kennedy, who was very involved in Hollywood in the 20s and 30s. It's all the same. The distribution, portals are different. The software is different. The people who do it are different. It's all the same. It never changes. That's as simple as answer I can give you. And what was the Georgetown question? Sorry.
Georgetown, how does it influence your life today? And you were part of Georgetown Entertainment and Media Alliance founding back in the day with Rich Batista. And you've been a part of it forever as a parent, but also involved at the university. So,
yeah, listen, I love Georgetown. It was an incredible experience for me. I met the greatest human beings who are still such close friends of mine now. Even when I put this thing up on my Instagram and when, when this was announced, I got so many people, Lizanne Boyle and other people who were texting this all around. You got to tune in. Like, we have such a supportive class. And so I'm fortunate to have those friendships, and I wanted to give back. And I was involved in the Georgetown Entertainment Media Alliance, the founding of that, which I take zero credit for. Rich Batista is a real doer and did the whole thing, but I was proud to be a part of that. And I'm always proud to try and be here to help young Hoyas figure out their way into Hollywood. It's much easier now. And there are tons of Georgetown people in Hollywood now. In the halls of CAA, there are a bunch. So I love to give back. I went and taught a master class for the film and media minor a few years ago, like 5 years ago now, 6 years ago. I was very involved in that minor and fundraising for that. And, Georgetown's a very, very important place for me in my history and life.
Me as well.
I'm looking at the clock. I see we're running out of time here. So
you got a minute. What's ahead? So you're only 35 years in. What inspires you to keep on going? And where do you think you want to go from here?
The mortgage on my New York apartment, Julie.
Real inspiration.
It's still like, I still read scripts and get inspired by storytelling and clients still doing great stuff. And Tom Dempsey's back, because I didn't mention his name, Demps. I'm getting all these texts as I sit here. Demps, I love you. You're my pal. We shared a lot of things we can't share on this Zoom at Georgetown. Just leave it at that. Anyway, I still love what I do. I want to do it for a long time. I thought by the time I'm 60 and I'd be done with this. But the truth is, 60 is so young these days, and I still love it. And I love great storytelling. That's why I still do what I do.
I think everyone from the class of 88 would say that 60 is still very young. We're at time, but if you could say one thing to Hoyas today who are inspired to follow your path from the Hilltop to Hollywood, what would you say?
First of all, I'd say hi to Virginia Van Dyke, who just texted me that. Everyone's on my ass right now.
Throwing my script out.
What would I say to say that? I'm sorry, the question again, I was distracted.
What would you say for students today who want to go from the Hilltop to Hollywood?
Come out to LA, go to New York if you want, but really LA is where you got to be. Get a job at an agency, learn the business that way. You can spend a couple years in an agency. You'll get a full view of the business, and then you'll be able to create your path wherever you want to go. If you want to go to production, onto the buyer's side, if you want to go into the entertainment law, if you want to go into publicity, it's the best way. Plus, you'll have a lot of fun and you'll make a lot of relationships that will last a lifetime. The guys and girls who run studios now are all people I grew up with. In fact, they're starting to age out now. It's weird. Like all my peers are now starting to climb that mountain and kind of falling off the cliff a little bit, because that's how this business works. It's constantly regenerating itself. So, but come out to LA and work in an agency. That's the best advice I can give.
Great advice. Good perspective. Thank you, Eddy, for joining us today, for being such a great Hoya. And thank you to everyone for being with us today. Come join us next time for 1789 Seconds next month, I think it is. Tune in. You're awesome. Hoya Saxa.
See ya. Bye.
Bye.
Hoya Saxa.